It's camcorder review time again, and this one is small enough that you probably don't even realize where it is among all this stuff on my table. But it's actually right here. It's the Sony HDR-TG5V Pure Titanium camcorder from 2010. This is one of a series of titanium handheld camcorders that Sony had around 2008 to 2010. The first models were the HDR TG1 and TG3. They were the same except the TG1 was the North American NTSC version and the TG3 was the European PAL version. Those were introduced in 2008. The TG1 sold for $899 US and the TG3 sold for 522 British pounds. And you may recognize someone famous who used one of those camcorders when he first started making YouTube videos.
Okay, give me a second here. I just want to give you a quick history lesson into the cameras that I've been using over the last, say, 10 years or so. The most recent one is this. It's a Sony TG3, also known as a TG1 in the US, and it's a very small, pocketable device, and I really like using it.
And this one, the TG5, was the successor to those models. It was also sold as the TG7 in Europe. Again, the same thing, just difference between PAL and NTSC. This one, the TG5V, which has the GPS feature and 16 gigs of built-in memory, sold for $999, so $1,000 for one of these 10 years ago. There was a cheaper model, the TG5 without the V, which did not have the built-in memory or the GPS. I don't know what that sold for, but it was less expensive. I got this on eBay a couple years ago. I don't remember what I paid for it, but these usually go for around $150 of all the accessories. And I'd never really used it because I preferred using my Canon camcorder, which I'm using right now. But I was recently inspired by a video by Marcus Pix called World's Cheapest and Amazing Camcorders Epic Video, where he featured one of these and he was really impressed by it.
This little Sony TG5V has better skin tones than even the more expensive video cameras. It's amazing. This little thing is so flat and small you can literally fit it in your pocket. The flip out screen is a touch screen, so you can do spot meter, spot focus, you can do manual white balance, all kinds of stuff. But what's really impressive about this camera is it has image stabilization. For a tiny little thing the size of a deck of cards that have image stabilization, it's just amazing. This is like great for vlogging.
As for a size comparison, here it is compared to a semi-modern LG smartphone. So it's a little bit smaller than any typical smartphone, but obviously a lot thicker. The way you operate one of these, you just flip open the LCD and it automatically turns on. And you hold it like that. Sort of a pistol grip type arrangement. Has a built-in flash for taking photos and automatic lens cover. When you shut it off, it automatically covers the lens, and you can flip it around to record yourself. Just give it a second to turn on, it automatically flips the image. So you can see the camcorder I'm using to record this, or you can fold it against the camcorder body, and that automatically switches it into playback mode. But if you want to switch back to recording mode, you just push that button on the touchscreen, and now you can record video with it folded in like that, which is the only way you can have it where it will stand up by itself. Otherwise, if this is flipped out, it's going to be too heavy on that side and it'll just fall over. Which is the one disadvantage of this layout. It doesn't really stand up that well. Featuring full HD 1080 video, 16 gigabytes of internal storage for up to 6 hours of video recording at the lowest bit rate. GPS and map feature, Carl Zeiss Vario Tessar lens, AVC HD recording. There on the top you can see the built-in stereo microphone. I know it looks like a single grill, but that is a stereo microphone. Advertises the GPS feature, Exmor 4.0 megapixel interpolated. That's not the actual resolution of the lens, but that's the maximum still image recording you can take with it. But it does 1080i HD video and also standard definition video. It's switchable. Controls on the back are a little bit strange. This is the video recording button, and this is the button for taking photos. There's no switch to go between them. What you do if you want to switch between video and photos, you just lightly press either button and it'll automatically switch to the relevant mode. And then you push it farther in to actually take a photo or start recording video. This is the zoom wheel, and it's the one thing I can never get used to because it looks like a knob, so you think you would turn it clockwise to zoom in, like turning up the volume control on a stereo, but to zoom in, it's actually going that way. It's going the opposite way. So I can never quite get the hang of this. Has 10 times optical zoom. Has a Memory Stick Pro Duo slot in addition to the built-in memory. Takes InfoLithium H batteries. There you can see the date code. 0 means 2010. It was made in Japan. DC input for charging or to operate the camcorder on a power supply. AV output, which is only standard definition. There's the tripod mount without the locator pin. And there's the jack for the Handycam station, which is pretty much a required accessory. It would have originally come with this when he bought it new, but these days when you buy one of these on eBay, try to find one of these with the Handycam station. Under where the LCD closes, you can see the brushed finish of the pure titanium body and the tiny built-in speaker. And there's also a lanyard strap, which is important because there's no hand strap like a regular Handycam. So in case it slips out of your hand, you best have this on so it doesn't go crashing to the ground. And you may not realize this when you first get one of these, but there's a door that opens here. You just push it to the side and it pops open. That's for the battery, which is removable. There's a switch for turning on or off the GPS, a reset button, and the Memory Stick Pro Duo slot if you want to use one of those cards instead of the built-in memory, or if you have the 5 regular model, not the 5V, you have to use one of those because it does not have the built-in memory. Of course, when I want to get a good shot of some flags, there's no wind blowing. These are all the accessories I got with it. Owner's manual, the world's cheapest and flimsiest USB cable. I'm not sure if this was an original Sony part or just something that someone threw in the box. It works, but it's just very, very thin. The power supply for charging, the Handycam station, a spare battery. And if we look inside here, here's the main battery. It's an InfoLithium H Actiforce battery, NPFH50. This one is also compatible, the FH30, lower capacity, but the same size, so it'll fit. But anything bigger than this will not fit. It may be forwards compatible with the later V series InfoLithium batteries, such as the FV30, but the only V series battery I have is the FV50, which is larger and does not fit in the camcorder, so I'm unable to test it, but it should work. But it is not backwards compatible with the older P series battery, like this FP50. If I put this one in, it'll fit and the camcorder will turn on, and at first everything looks like it's gonna work, but if you give it a couple seconds, it says cannot use this battery in the camcorder with an error code. And here is the aforementioned Handycam station, which clips into the bottom of the camcorder like that. Sony's idea was you can leave this thing plugged in, and when you're done using the camcorder, just put it on top there, and you don't really need to connect any cables because it just connects automatically with that port on the bottom there. But it gives you another AV output, just like the one on the camcorder itself, and that's for one of these cables. This was sort of a Sony standard for a while, so it shouldn't be too difficult finding one of these. It gives you composite video, S-video, and stereo audio. But it also has HDMI output for HD video output, another DC input jack for charging, and a USB port for transferring your videos to a computer. That's why it's very important to have a Handycam station go with this, because the camcorder itself does not have a USB port on it. It only has this special jack on the bottom, the DC input, and the AV output. Sony originally did have an adapter which would plug into this jack on the bottom here and give you a USB output, but good luck finding one of those these days. And a quick look through some of the features of this thing. I won't go through all of them because that would take too long. Like I said, it's a touchscreen. I customized this menu. It does not come this way from the factory. You can see the My Menu Setting button where you can change these presets. This one switches it between high definition and standard definition. Standard definition is 720 by 480 if you have an NTSC version, or 720 by 576 if you have a PAL version. And you can change the recording mode. FH is the only one that takes 1920 by 1080 full HD video. All the other ones are 1440 by 1080 anamorphic. The high quality version is 9 megabits per second. Standard play is 7 megabits and long play is 5 megabits, while the FH is 16 megabits. So those are your recording options. You also get similar choices if you are doing standard definition, so I'll switch over to that. So now we're in standard definition mode. If we go back into that menu, we can see our choices are high quality, 9 megabits, standard 6 megabits, or long play, which is 3 megabits. And if you are in standard definition mode, you get a choice of either widescreen or 4x3, which cuts off the sides. It has steady shot. I do not know if it's optical or electronic image stabilization, but it does work pretty well. You can switch it into manual focus, and you can change the microphone reference level. It's not a fully manual level control, but you do get a choice of either normal or low. Low is better for loud environments, like taking one of these to a concert or something. And like I said, this one has GPS, and it actually works really well. Even under tree cover, it was able to find my location when I was recording outside. I'm not in New York City right now, but I scrolled over there, and you can scroll around the map, and you can zoom in. It doesn't really have street-level views, but it does get pretty well zoomed in. That's 500 feet, 200 feet, and 100 feet is the closest. So it should be able to find your location to within 100 feet. Here's some video recorded outside this afternoon, and it actually gives you the coordinates of where I was when I was recording this. So that's really neat. Here's a video I took at a different location. You can see the coordinates are different for that one. So I thought the GPS feature would just be a gimmick, but I'm actually really impressed by it. It works very well. And here is taking a photo of the built-in flash. So enough yapping, let's take some test footage with this thing. So there's the Canon camcorder I was just using to record the first part of this video. There's all the objects on my table. This is recording in the FH mode, which is 1920 by 1080 HD. Here's the full extent of the zoom. It does have digital zoom, but I have that turned off right now. And here it is, recording in standard definition. iMovie does not have very good deinterlacing, so the quality could actually look quite a bit better than this if I put it through my high quality deinterlacing. But for now, I'll just use iMovie. So that'll just be a quick sample of what this looks like in standard definition. And here it is in standard definition 4:3 aspect ratio. Here's a semi-low light test. This camcorder does not really do that well in low light. Even with the automatic slow shutter turned on, it gets quite grainy. As you can probably tell, if YouTube's compression has not totally smoothened it out. So that's it for my review and test of the Sony Handycam HDR-TG5 Pure Titanium GPS camcorder from 2010. Obviously, things have moved on quite a bit in the technology of video since then. Now camcorders are pretty much extinct. There are still a few models, but for the consumer market, pretty much everyone is either using their smartphone or a GoPro type action camera or a DSLR to record video these days. Not too many people still using camcorders. And this one sort of bridges the gap between the more portable action type camcorders and the more traditional camcorders like the Canon I normally use. So some people still may be interested in a camcorder like this. So you can quite easily find these on eBay. About $100 to $150 usually. Just make sure you get one with the Handycam station. The only real problem that you might encounter with these is that on ones that have been heavily used, the spring that holds open the LCD goes weak and it tends to sag down like that, so you may have to prop it open with your finger while you're using it, but not too big of a deal. Otherwise, these seem to be very reliable and still perfectly usable today. Even the batteries still hold a good charge after 10 years. So if this is one of those things you wanted to get 10 years ago but couldn't afford the $1,000 price tag, it may be worth getting one of these today.